Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Wow, welcome to Vancouver. How many folks got in yesterday here in Vancouver? Quite a few of you, most of you. What amazing weather we had yesterday. What a beautiful place. I mean, just when you go out to my right and just look over that harbor, it is an amazing place to be. We're happy that you're all here with us in Vancouver this week. We are looking at having a really, really fun week. We have amazing people here, both in the audience and on stage, lots of interesting conversations and technical topics and all sorts of conversations to have. But before we get started, I definitely want to take the time to thank our sponsors, our diamond sponsors, IBM, Intel, and SUSE. Let's give them a hand. And most importantly, our platinum sponsor, Red Hat, a name well known to everyone in open source. Also, I definitely want to give a shout out to our program chairs and content committee. All of the amazing content you're going to see this week was curated by the folks you see here on the screen. John O'Bacon, Greg Crowe-Hartman, Donnie Burkholz, Brian Lyles, Robin Bergeron, and Neithia Ruff. Let's give them a round of applause. They made it happen. I do also want to take a moment to call out some of the diversity and inclusion initiatives that we have at our event. This is one of these things that all of us can agree on. We want to see more and more at our events, in our technical communities, in every aspect of our professional and personal lives. And to that end, we have a Diversity Empowerment Summit here at the Open Source Summit. This is 3 days of talks covering a wide range of topics. We have speed mentoring, we have a women in open source lunch today, which we have every year, you should stop by. We have a diversity social, and the final thing that I really love about the diversity and inclusion initiatives here, for anyone who's been at multiple Linux Foundation events, it is almost certain that you have met my 10-year-old daughter, Nisha, because we provide free childcare for all working parents at all of our events. We have a nursing room, we have stickers for the kids. Thank you. The thing I'd like to tell all of you is, for goodness sake, take advantage of this, because sometimes Nisha gets a little bit lonely if there are not other kids. So I really encourage you to do that. It makes the event so much better to see families, parents who are able to take the time and work and talk with their peers, but then have their kids and enjoy both. Finally, we have a strict code of conduct at this event. It's available online, but you know, the easy way to think about it is we just want to make this a safe, inviting, welcoming place for everyone. So in that spirit, we have created that code of conduct, and if there are any issues, we have staff all over the place, and we're always here to help. So again, I want to welcome everyone to our Open Source Summit North America, and you know, I thought I would take a little bit of time to talk about a subject that I talk about quite often, but is at a special place in time for all of us, in that open source as a movement, both from a technological perspective, from an innovation perspective, and from even a social perspective, just continues to have an amazing, amazing impact on the world. And you know, we have folks at this event that make it really, really special in that you have people here who have been leaders in the open source movement for nearly two decades. I'm looking at Chris DeBona here, right in the front row. Did I get a shout out there for Chris? You know, Brian Bellendorf's here. You know, you'll see Linus Torvalds, folks who've been working in open source for, you know, 20, 25 years. And then we have so many new people who are coming to our communities and participating in open source development and in our communities in a variety of ways. And that makes it just incredibly special and an amazing time. The thing that I sort of, when I look back at, you know, now 27 years, I guess, of Linux, it is amazing to look at where we're at today in terms of the impact. When I first got started, I love to tell the story about my, maybe this was 15 years ago, I was on my first blind date with my now wife, and she asked me what I did for a living. I said, well, I work at this open source organization, and you know, it's about sharing software, and it's a nonprofit, and it's Linux, which she had, of course, never heard of. The look of disappointment was palpable, like glancing at her watch. But I overcame all of that, and I'm happily married to this day. And Linux has equally matured in its relationship with society in that it's 100% of the supercomputer market, which ticked over, I think, last year, just completely overtook that market. With Android, 80% of the mobile market, most public cloud workloads. I mean, it's just amazing to see how Linux has become this massive, incredible success story. And at the Linux Foundation, we are honored to be a part of that growth even beyond Linux, doing initiatives across the technical map. You know, one thing you might not know about the Linux Foundation is one of our projects is the world's largest certificate authority. How many people here have heard of Let's Encrypt? All right, because there are quite a few of you. Apt-get Let's Encrypt, I mean, how easy is that? It's a free TLS certificate. The idea here is to make the internet secure by providing an easy-to-use and free certificate. Let's encrypt the entire web. In networking, we have an amazing set of projects. In cloud computing, has anybody here heard of Kubernetes? It's the new thing that everyone loves. Not so new necessarily, but it's certainly the topic du jour. In our automotive group, automotive grade Linux, it is now rolling in production vehicles, millions of production vehicles worldwide. It wouldn't be a technical conference if we didn't say blockchain. Brian Bellendorf, who originally was one of the founders of the Apache Software Foundation, wrote a bunch of the Apache web server. We kind of took him out of work that he was doing in the private equity business and had him come back to Linux Foundation running our Hyperledger project, which really aims to sort of redefine distributed trust on the internet. And you're gonna hear more about blockchain throughout the day. We have edge and embedded projects, web, I think everybody here knows Node.js. So we've really, open source and the Linux Foundation as part of it has grown to all these amazing projects. And the numbers this year are just crazy. And that's one of the things I did want to share with all of you today is this is probably the best year and one of the most robust times that the Linux Foundation itself has ever seen. We have, you know, over 1,300 organizations that are members of the foundation from countries all over the world. Tens of thousands of developers contributing to the various projects that the Linux Foundation hosts. And this is creating billions of dollars in value for all of us to share and use at no cost. The thing that I love, and this continues to this day, now we're literally at the end of August, rolling into the fall here, for the entire year of 2018, the Linux Foundation has been adding a new member every single day. It is just amazing to be a part of that and to see all these new organizations and all these new developers come and participate in these projects. We were recognized late last year, and I think this was interesting, by the SD Times, which is a publication in Silicon Valley, as a recipient of their Influencer Award. What's interesting about this is, A, the fact that we are up with organizations like Apple and Facebook and Google as a nonprofit organization, but what's more interesting to me is the fact that GitHub, Red Hat, and the Linux Foundation, three of these influencers, which is really sort of defined by those organizations that define how people use technology day to day and create technology, three of them are open source. It's just amazing to see that change in the technology industry and these new heights. And obviously at the foundation, we focus on, across all of these projects, really the same goal, which is to be the best upstream for a vibrant downstream. to create good open source projects that create value, that can be used to create products and services based on open source code that then would create profit or value for government, maybe more transparency, whatever that value might be, that then gets reinvested back into the project, largely in the form of developers like you working and contributing code to those projects, which begets more products, services, different technology innovation, begets more value, that returns in the form of more code, and that virtuous cycle continues. This is really what we're trying to do. What I'd like for everyone to discuss this week, and we have all kinds of tracks, whether it's technical or governance or legal or you name it, is how can we all make these gears of upstream projects that become commercial or academic or government solutions that create value, how can we make these things spin faster? This is something that I think all of us can collectively think about so that we can all get better outcomes and then bring more people into our communities. And at the foundation, we've been thinking a lot about this, and this is just our view of the world. The Linux Foundation is not the only organization in the world, and certainly shouldn't necessarily be. There are great organizations, the Eclipse Foundation, the Apache Software Foundation, do an amazing job of doing similar work to this, which is how to be a great upstream, how to build trust across different organizations, different developers, provide a home for the intellectual property assets and the co-development activity that make open source projects great, get those projects up and running, bring developers to the party, provide training and certification programs so that developers can learn technology more quickly than they might have in a more organic way of doing things by providing some resources to help with that, and so on and so forth. Tracking community health. Yesterday we had our community health and analytics for open source day. Tracking what it means to be a healthy open source project. Mean time to pull requests, developer velocity, test coverage, et cetera, et cetera. What we're working on here and what I would encourage everyone to think about is how can we really bring a robust methodology to the table around how to make an upstream open source project great? That's the challenge that we at the Linux Foundation really want to tackle. What we then do is hand it off. And this is where for folks who, how many people here use open source in your job to create some technology or service that you offer to your customers or in government? So a huge percentage of the folks in the audience here. What we want to do is be able to have our communities hand code off so that you all can pull code into your organizations, make the changes that you need to create whatever product or service that you care about, whether it's providing a Kubernetes service on Google's cloud platform or Azure or Amazon, or creating an automotive vehicle experience in Lexus or you name it. We want to help organizations pull code in, modify it, and then equally importantly, share the changes that they made back with the upstream community to beget that cycle. Better code, more subsequent experiences, product services, more reinvestment, and so forth. So we have tracks this week on how to be a good open source program office manager. I'm going to pick on Chris here because he's one of the originals. I'm sorry, Chris, but you sat right in the front row. I can't help myself. Chris is one of the original folks. Google was one of the earliest companies to formalize the concept of having an open source program office. That organization within Google is the group that helps understand what code Google wants to use, how to bring it into the organization, make changes, make sure that license compliance happens in a systematic and very robust way, how to allow Google engineers to share back, rewards Google employees for sharing back with the community. They recently had some awards around this, created Summer of Code and so forth. What we see over and over as we add a new member every day to our organization is we get the same question asked over and over and over again, which is, tell me how I can manage external R&D. Tell me how I can be a good consumer of open source, rapidly integrated into our projects, and then help me teach my management, maybe my lawyers, how to share code back in our business processes so that we can get really, really good at using and leveraging open source code, which obviously means faster time to market, better business value, and so forth. So there are just, again, talks and tracks this week, all sorts of peers who have had this experience that can teach you, if you're new to open source, how to do this. Finally, one of the things that we're working on, and you're going to see more research coming out of the Linux Foundation, is how can we measure the value of all of this? Because the question I get generally after, like, how do we use open source effectively, is how can I, if it's all free, how does anybody get paid? Or how can I ascribe value to all of this? And so what we've been doing is looking at how different organizations pull in open source, where they capture value, how they measure that, how the economics of open source work, how does sort of the labor economics work, how do the social systems work, how do we quantify and ascribe value to this? And that's, I think, an important story to tell because there is tremendous value being created here. You know, nobody builds anything these days without open source, and there is a good reason for that, whether or not we've explicitly quantified that from an academic perspective or not. It is just so obvious that you're not going to go build your own operating system when you have this stuff freely available. You can bring it in, build whatever you want with it, go to market quickly, take advantage of the collective innovation that's happening there. There's massive value there. So look forward, and you'll see, again this week, tracks and sessions on how to measure business value of open source projects and this discussion happening. And you know, the last thing that we think about a lot at the foundation is how to be a good organization from sort of a meta developer relations perspective. How do we bring more developers into our projects? But this year I think has been special in that we've been seeing a new pattern emerging, and we're really looking at taking a new set of initiatives that goes beyond just bringing in one developer at a time. We really aspire, and my entire team here and all the people who work in our communities aspire, to bring in entire industries at a time. You know, there are industries out there that are incredibly well suited for taking advantage of collective development and open source methodologies, you know, where they have a business that they need to run. It's maybe not necessarily a technical business, but they're going through a software transformation where they want to leverage, you know, software effectively, and they can gain a lot of advantage of, instead of competing with each other for underlying technology, collaborating on it will help an entire industry. And we've just found this over and over again at the foundation. One of the most recent ones that I think is really interesting is the Academy Software Foundation. We launched this a couple weeks ago at SIGGRAPH. How many people heard of our Academy Software Foundation initiative? A few of you? A few folks? I think there's some Academy Software Foundation folks in the audience today, and there's, I think, a couple of talks on it as well. But a couple of years ago, I was brought to a meeting at the Motion Picture Academy with this year the folks who bring us the Oscars down in Los Angeles, and they had this problem, which is, you know, all of the major film studios and their partners are really in the storytelling business and not necessarily in the technology business. But it may surprise you, or maybe not, because you probably go to all these movies, the big CGI and digital effects driven films drive a humongous percentage of the profit in Hollywood. And in some cases really subsidize all the amazing art films that people also enjoy. So this is like a massive part of how the film industry works. And a group of us got together, led by both the Academy and a gentleman named Rob Brito, who is the head of Industrial Light of Magic, who's an amazing person, to figure out how all the large film studios, Disney, DreamWorks, etc., could work together to create a common set of technologies and production pipeline software together. And so for the first time in history, the Academy has lent their name to a project at the Linux Foundation, an organization you know, they don't necessarily control, to show to the world that they really value open source and this kind of collective development, which is just amazing to see. I'm also hoping for at least a seat filler position at the Oscars someday, but I'll take this effort as well. To find out more about this, go to the Academy Software Foundation. There's a link on the Linux Foundation website to get involved. Rob, who, again, he's the head of IOM, he's, if you watch the latest Solo movie from Lucasfilms, Rob, I think, is the third name in the credits when the film ends. Just an amazing guy. He recently did an interview where he said, listen, this is where we're going to find talent at ILM. So if you're interested in getting your foot in the door at Industrial Light and Magic, go check out this effort and you know dive right in, and that's a terrific way to advance your career and to get into that industry. You know, another initiative that we have been working on is our Open Network Automation Platform. This initiative we started to solve a problem of software automation and networking. As we move to 5G and networks getting massive and more users and more data, you need to automate all this. And we worked with China Mobile and AT&T a couple years ago to create the Open Network Automation Platform, which is used to manage all of this infrastructure. And just in a couple of years, this is already saving telecommunication providers billions of dollars in managing their networks. What an amazing thing. And it brought the entire telecommunications industry, literally 70% of the world's operators, into open source. It's just amazing to see these people innovating and working in open source. In automotive, we partnered with Toyota and a dozen other automotive OEMs to bring open source into the production experience in your car. The information, the navigation, the cluster, the heads-up display. This software has over 230 organizations participating in it, hundreds of developers. It is in the Toyota Camry, Lexus vehicles today. And finally, last but not least, the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, which has seen incredible growth at the LF. This was started back in 2015, just a few years ago, to solve the problem of portability across different clouds. As we move more software to the cloud, it was clear that the idea of container and microservice technology, cloud native development, was an important shift that the industry needed to make. And it was important that there be a standard way to manage those containers to create ease of portability across these clouds. Started in 2015 with a small group of organizations led by Google, largely with Kubernetes as the centerpiece of that organization. And in just 3 years, we have hundreds of companies, 50 Kubernetes service providers. It really is becoming one of the most important open source projects in the world. So you can see here how project after project, we're bringing wholesale industry solving these huge problems here at the foundation, and we're so proud of doing that. But the question that I would like to ask is sort of, what is new? Where are we going from here? And to announce something new, I'd like to welcome to the stage Sarah Novotny from Google. She is the open source strategy lead at Google Cloud. I think a lot of people know Sarah already. She's on my board of directors. She's technically my boss, so please welcome. So Sarah, you have a fun announcement today about, I was just talking about Kubernetes,
yeah.
The Cloud Native Computing Foundation. Tell me what you got.
One of the maddest growing projects on the planet. We're coming after Linux, just so you know. You've called it the Linux of the cloud.
I have called it the Linux of the cloud.
So with the story that Google has worked with the Linux Foundation here, trying to build a community-led project, there's been a lagging component that we needed to externalize. Our entire CI/CD infrastructure has been controlled still by Google engineers, because that's just an artifact of how it was built and engaged. And with this announcement, which I'm still leading for a moment. With this announcement, we're actually bringing out into public projects the ability for more community members to get involved with the infrastructure portion and the infrastructure build CI, CD, and testing components of Kubernetes. And so the big announcement is that Google is committing $9 million of contribution to the Cloud Native Computing Foundation to cover all of the CI/CD infrastructure, testing infrastructure for Kubernetes, and externalizing these projects so that anyone from the community who is interested in this work can step up and join SIG testing, working in the contributor experience group, and being able to actually get that much more involved.
That's first of all, thank you. That is amazing. $9 million is not a small amount of money.
No.
You know, we were talking earlier, and I think Google doesn't get enough credit on this one. You know, testing is one of the things where, you know, everyone's like, oh, yeah, you got to have more testing, but nobody wants to do it. It's sort of like, you know, the bathrooms are never clean enough.
Yep.
It's true. But, you know, this is obviously generous in two ways.
Mm-hmm.
One, I feel like a kid in maybe CNCF where you turn 16, you're getting this amazing brand new car, you're giving the keys with the caveat,
yes,
you gotta drive safe, this is your responsibility now. And by sort of turning this infrastructure over to the community, more people are gonna be able to dive in, get in there, add to testing, make contributions to the CI/CD systems. And so that's certainly a great thing for the project.
We very much want more people to be involved. And this isn't us just saying, here is the infrastructure, good luck, Godspeed. It is in continued engagement from Google. We are committed to also reevaluating the number as the 3 years pass, because we know that Kubernetes has been growing insanely. As I said, we're coming after Linux for fastest growing project. We know that as we bring in more community and we get more test coverage, that this is something that is going to change. And these numbers didn't just come out of how much would we like to give today. They came out of what we have seen as our historical growth over the last 3 years in the infrastructure that we've been running internally. We're just actually finally sharing that number.
That's amazing. I want to thank you so much. The $9 million in infrastructure, but also for the leadership. You know, Google is a great example of an organization that sees ahead and is able to share and compete at the same time, you know, meets your business objectives, but also is working collectively. So
we can't do it without the community. There's been more than 10,000 different people participating in the most recent release. So
that's amazing.
It's huge.
All right, and check out KubeCon Shanghai and in Seattle, because it's going to be an amazing
set
of
events. They will be huge.
All right, thank you, Sarah. All right. We've got a couple more announcements today. This just keeps going. One, we want to give a shout out to our Open Mainframe project announcing the launch of Zowie. This is a set of open source tools and frameworks on ZOS. So for I know there's a bunch of mainframe folks out there. Go and check that out. As per our previous conversation with Sarah, Kubernetes and the Cloud Native Computing Foundation are one of the fastest growing projects, I think actually the fastest growing project at the foundation, and recently did a survey to show how people are using cloud native technologies, what pace organizations are adopting it. That survey was just published this week. Go check it out. We're seeing amazing triple digit growth in the use of these technologies across the world. Finally, you know, I was talking about this idea of open source program office management, giving Chris a little bit of a hard time, but according to the new stack and our to-do group, this is an actual thing. This is a meaningful movement across the industry where company after company that we're talking to are now all building these open source software programs. If your organization doesn't have one, you know, an easy way to think about it is if you're spending millions and millions or billions on internal R&D, how do you manage the external R&D, the billions of dollars worth of software value created in open source outside your organization? And go check out this new stack report, which tells us that a lot of people are figuring out ways to do that programmatically. Finally, I want to welcome the 51 new members that have joined the Linux Foundation just in July. We are happy to see so many of these organizations coming with developers to our projects. Most of these companies are here this week being represented by developers or folks from their open source programs. So be sure and look for these new folks in our community and welcome them to our world. So in closing, you know, what we want to do at the foundation, and we hope you all join us, is to bring in new people to our world, one developer at a time, one project at a time, and one wholesale industry at a time. And at this moment in time, what I can tell you is that every indicator is up and to the right. And so we should all be proud of the kind of work that's going on in these communities. And thank you so much for all the work that you do.